Formula One car. It's one of the fastest modes of transportation the world has ever seen. It takes millions and millions of dollars and years to develop a car like this, a car that can take corners, accelerate faster than some fighter planes. As a matter of fact, the drivers of Formula One cars experience lateral G-forces, even those that exceed what fighter pilots do. And driving a Formula One car is a lot like playing the violin. You have to respond immediately, almost telepathically, to both the car and your surroundings, and the car has to do the same, much like the violin does. It has to respond to immediate inputs in order to create something fast, in the case of the car, or expressive, in the case of the violin. This is Ayrton Senna. He is known to be one of the greatest racing drivers of all times in Formula One. But his start in Formula One was fairly inauspicious. He was a Brazilian fellow, and he had kind of a lukewarm career in Formula 2, the racing series that often feeds Formula One. And in 1984, a very small but we'll call them energetic company called Tolman hired Senna mid-season, trying to do something to break their losing streak. Consistently, the two Tolman cars were placing dead last on the grid, 19th and 20th places. On a good day, they could swing 18th. And they wanted to switch things up, see if they could change the chemistry of the team in order to do better. And sure enough, by the end of 1984, after Senna joined Tolman, Tolman was fighting for 9th, 10th, and 11th place rather than dead last on the grid. The next year in 1985, another plucky company called Lotus noticed this and said, that's interesting. I wonder if there's a little bit of alchemy going on there with this Brazilian dude. And they hired him. Lotus was consistently placing in the midfield. 9th, 10th, 11th, sometimes 8th on a good day. And they wanted to be fighting for podiums. 1st, 2nd, 3rd place with the likes of Ferrari and McLaren. The very well-funded teams. And sure enough, by the second year Senna was driving for Lotus, both of the Lotus cars consistently wound up on the podium. Coincidence? McLaren didn't think so. McLaren, one of the most well-funded teams in the Formula One series, noticed what Senna had done at Tolman, noticed what Senna had done at Lotus, and said, I wonder if there's something to this guy. I wonder if he can take our rivalry with Ferrari, and if he can help us pull out front. I wonder if he can help us dominate Formula One. And sure enough, in 1988, they hired him to do just that. By the end of 1988, McLaren, sure enough, both cars were dominant in the field of Formula One. As a matter of fact, Senna and his teammate, the Frenchman Alain Prost, were each other's only rivals. It wasn't a question of what team would win. Would Ferrari win? Would McLaren win? No, it was a question of would Senna win or would Prost win? Ferrari was no longer even a contender to win races. At the time, the boss of McLaren, Ron Dennis, said, Ayrton was fastidious. He was relentless with our engineers. He made sure they understood everything wrong with driving the car that they couldn't figure out from reading readouts. If the car was not an extension of his mind, it wasn't good and it wasn't race-worthy. He threatened to leave McLaren daily if we weren't as urgent about his complaints as he was. Naturally, we made the same adjustments to his teammate's car, right? And this is crucial. The media noticed, right? When you sign with McLaren, people watch you, and they noticed Senna was not going to press conferences after races, after practice. He was not going to parties after races or after practices. He was literally jumping out of the car and running back to the garage to complain to the engineers and the mechanics. And within months of showing up at a new team, both of their cars were faster because of this process of collaboration between Senna and the engineers. 1988, Senna became world champion. 1989, his teammate, world champion. 1990, 1991, Senna, world champion. 1992, he got bored. 1992, he decided, I'm going to go to this smaller company, midfield team called Williams-Renault. They had some interesting technology he wanted to help them develop. And that first year, at the Italian Grand Prix, the press noticed something weird. Senna was in a really bad mood. He was screaming at the Williams engineers. He was ranting, he was stomping his feet, he was throwing tantrums, complaining that the suspension doesn't feel right. It doesn't do what it should. The car doesn't behave the way it should. It doesn't behave predictably. The boss of Williams at the time wrote, "We made it to look like we were resetting the suspension setup, but we felt little could be done to improve the feel of the car." In other words, Senna complained and complained and complained, and no one listened. 4 hours later, in the Italian Grand Prix, this is what happened.
Minerali dropping down to approach it at about 150 miles an hour, and there's a gap after the second salvo of Wendlinger. Okio came down far more than his performance here looks. It looks that perhaps that was a Benetton smokescreen. I'm not quite sure why he's so hot in the warm-up, but he is really not losing much to Senna at all. I would say basically he's right with him. Well, we are right with Michael Schumacher now. That's Senna! My goodness! I just saw him plunge off to the right, and Senna has joined the two.
4 hours later, Senna hit a concrete wall traveling about 200 miles an hour. A corner where no one else ever crashed, ever. And he was dead about 10 minutes later on the way to the hospital. So what are the takeaways here? What can we learn from
Minerali
the and the tragedies of Senna's life? Well, firstly, when drivers and engineers collaborate, they create fast cars. He proved that at Tolman, he proved that at Lotus, he proved that at McLaren. Crucially, when drivers and engineers stop that line of communication, when they stop listening, when they start to ignore each other, dangerous cars result. Now, when we play the violin, fortunately, our lives are not on the line. We're not at risk of plunging into a concrete barrier and losing our lives. But our livelihoods are at risk, right? Senna turned left, the car went right. If we do that, if our violin does that, if it behaves unpredictably like that, that's the difference between showing up for a Boston Symphony audition and having a salary with the Boston Symphony. This matters in a major, major way. So why is it that there's so little cultural precedent, both historical and current, for string players to go back to the garage, to go work with luthiers, to work with violin makers, in a really invested way to create fast cars, right? Oftentimes we walk into the violin shop when we have the equivalent of a flat tire or an engine failure. You know, violin sounds awful. Okay, I guess I'd better go see the violin maker. And then we complain a bunch about, you know, using some ambiguous words, some ambiguous terminology that we think explains what's going on. And then the violin maker does some stuff that looks good, and you kind of figure, yeah, okay, I hope it's better. And it's different, but you may or may not actually have your concern addressed. The one thing that is certain is you'll have paid a lot of money for that experience. Why are we okay with that? In 2015, I happened upon a violin maker named Keith Hill in Nashville. I was dropping a friend off to have dinner with his wife, and I was taken around back to the violin shop in the garage where Keith was seated. And there was a violin on the table, and he noticed me looking at it because it was a good-looking violin. Beautiful varnish. He said, well, you know, if you want, you can play it. Go ahead, pick it up, play it. So I did, and I played a little bit on it. And I said what you'd say to someone you weren't trying to offend. I said, oh, this is nice. The sound is dark. Feels okay. That's cool, someone will like it, someone will like it. And then he looked me straight in the eye and he said, no, tell me everything that's wrong with it. Tell me everything that's wrong with it. And I did. I was blunt with him. I told him everything that was wrong with that instrument. And at the end of that conversation, he said, I'd like you to come back in a couple days. And a couple days later, I came back and he had every violin in the shop out in front of him. And we spent the next month working on each of those violins, workshopping those violins in preparation for a recording project where each of them would be played. And over that month-long span of working together, trying to bring these violins to the highest levels, we noticed a few problems with that collaboration. Firstly, there was no reciprocal trust in being blunt with each other. Now, fortunately, we sorted that out pretty quick in our first meeting. But remember, I had a really hard time telling him exactly what I thought about that violin on the table the first time. He had to ask me for it, right? But that takes a lot of trust, a lot of experience, typically, to build. Second problem, linguistic confusion. I say one thing, he interprets another thing. I say, I want this sound to be dark. I want this violin to have a darker sound. It's a little bit too bright. What does that mean? Right? I have an image of what that violin should sound like, but I guarantee you, each of you, when I say a violin that sounds dark, you envision a completely different sound from the person sitting next to you. That's a massive problem when you're trying to be specific about improving the acoustics of an instrument. Lastly, there was no gauge, no quantitative sense of the relative importance of problems or the relative importance of characteristics of sound or playability. Not only that, there's no gauge of how much of an improvement have we just made to the sound of that instrument or to the playability of that instrument, right? We can say it's better, but is that revolutionizing the instrument or is that, oh, it's a little bit better? There's no specific quantitative scale that we typically use when we talk to violin makers. So what I'm going to do today is share with you the solutions that Keith and I came to for addressing these three problems over the course of that month and in the 6 years that followed as we continue to collaborate. The solutions, principles of progress, right? Principles of progress. What are the fundamental, foundational ideas, notions of working together that pave the way for progress, that pave the way for improvement in instruments and successful communication between maker and player? Second, developing a language, untangling that linguistic confusion. How do you get on the same wavelength when you communicate with a maker? And lastly, we've devised a system of quantitative assessment that allows you to be specific and precise about the importance of these characteristics of sound and playability, and also the nature of the improvements or the problems. So, first things first, principles of progress. What on earth do you do? How do you think? How do you relate to each other in such a way that allows progress to happen? Firstly, leave your ego at home. Leave your ego at home. And the obvious application of that problem is the maker, right? The maker cannot be defensive of their work. Otherwise, they're not going to be open to criticism. However, I've also written both of you. The player also needs to leave the ego at home. Why? Because chances are the instrument you're working on is of some kind of significance to you. Either you own it and you want it to sound great, or you have some kind of vested interest in the maker's instrument sounding better. Right? If you're not willing to be honest about what's wrong with your instrument, then progress cannot be made. You have to be willing to be extremely critical of your own instrument, even though it's close to your heart. Words should be specific and precise. Words should be used only when you have an understanding of what they mean, and they should be used only when you intend that meaning. We're going to talk much more about that when we untangle linguistic confusion. Right? Criticism equals progress. This is crucial, and this is the case in any kind of collaboration where you're trying to improve something. Sources of criticism are also sources of progress. You have to be willing to admit that there's a problem with the instrument if you want to make the instrument better. And that's hard to do, and everyone has to be on the same page about that. Lastly, this one's a little bit nuts and bolts, but when Keith and I work together, we think of characteristics of an instrument as fitting in one of two categories, either characteristics of sound or characteristics of playability. In other words, how does the instrument sound versus how does the instrument feel to play? What's the player's experience when playing it? And oftentimes there are overlap between the two. Oftentimes characteristics of sound and playability overlap or relate to each other very concretely. But by and large, we're talking about these two umbrella categories in terms of characteristics of the instrument. So having laid this groundwork, that meant Keith and I could begin to develop a language for working with each other. And the principles that we use when we choose words, when we define words, when we make them specific enough to be used on a regular basis are as follows. When you choose a word to use, it has to be a term that both parties can relate to. You know, if I'm describing the sound of an instrument as, it's like the bow on the string feels like petting an Australian capybara. Okay, maybe I've done that, but the likelihood of anyone else having ever done that and knowing what that feels like is very slim. So you would never want to use that descriptor when talking about an instrument. It's not a term that both parties can relate to. Secondly, any terms that you decide to use, any terms that you add to your lexical toolbox, you have to be able to define them readily and clearly. In other words, if you start using words, you have to be on the same page about what they mean. Typically, we're going to be pulling from words that are often thrown around in very abstract ways, that are often used as synonyms of other words, when we no longer intend them to be. So you have to be able to explain exactly what you mean when you use one of these words. Lastly, we do our very best to use words that are auditory or tactile, because those are the ways that you experience the violin. We experience the violin by hearing it, and if you're the player, by feeling it, not by seeing it. Sound is not visual, therefore visual descriptors are intrinsically ambiguous, because you have to make an assumption. You have to draw a parallel with a word that doesn't literally mean what you're saying. And Keith said it better than I ever could in a conversation we recorded about a month ago in Nashville. So I'll leave this to him.
Well, I mean, just to, when you talk about tone, what do you mean by tone?
Right.
What do I mean by tone?
Right. And
what do I mean by timbre? What do you mean by bright? What do you mean by projection? What do you mean by silky? What do you mean by velvety? What do you mean by...
Yeah, and
all the words that we use to describe sound, none of which are discussing sound.
And that's the ultimate problem, right? We have to find words that apply to sound and apply to tactile sensations much more so than visual ones. So, I have these seven instruments here, all of which are made by Keith, and now I'm going to take you through some of the terms, some of the language that Keith and I have found most useful in describing the sound of violins as we bounce back and forth. These seven violins here do not represent the best violins Keith has made. As a matter of fact, some of these violins are acoustical experiments that didn't go very well. Right? These are not designed to be the cream of the crop. These are designed to show contrast in the characteristics of sound I'm about to show you. It's also worth mentioning that I've eliminated as many variables as possible in these instruments. They're all using the same strings. They're all using the same bow. All of the strings are relatively new. They're all going to be played by the same player. All of these aspects of an instrument vastly change the way it sounds. And I've done my best to eliminate as many of those variables as possible so we can see them on a one-to-one, apples-to-apples basis. So firstly, bigness. We use a lot of words, we throw them around in an effort to basically say, I want my violin to sound big. I want it to be audible, I want it to leave an impression with its sound. And three of those words, I call the three P's of bigness. We use them as synonyms, usually, but Keith and I have found it really crucial to separate them as synonyms and give them specific meanings. The three P's of bigness are power, projection, and presence. Power. In our world, power means something very specific within the sound. Power is volume, measurable in decibels, as you would perceive it right under the ear or very near above. Okay, so if I were to play one of these instruments right now, you all being all the way over there, you all being on the live stream, you would have no idea how much power the instrument is producing, because it has nothing to do with how well the sound carries. It's a sensation that's decipherable under the ear. And it's also worth noting that the spectrum of power, the two terms that we use to describe something with a lot of power or something with a little bit of power, are also specific to power. We talk about quiet versus loud, and those specifically describe power as opposed to projection, for example. Projection, on the other hand, is the ease of hearing an instrument over an ensemble. In other words, how easily distinguished is the sound of the instrument when competing with other noises, whether it be instruments or a jackhammer, right? It has to do with being discernible versus indiscernible over competing noise, competing sound. And that's completely different from presence. Presence being the ease of hearing an instrument over a distance, creating a sense of closeness. In other words, you being all the way on the other side of this large room, when I play a violin, does it sound like I'm on the other side of a large room? Or does that instrument actually sound like it's right in front of you, even though it's not? That is the essence of presence. And we would describe it as being distant or present, right? If it sounds distant, it sounds like I'm at a distance at the other side of a concert hall, okay? And keep in mind too, you can have presence without having power. An instrument that sounds quiet under the ear, that has low power, can actually carry over a space very successfully, can have a lot of presence. Presence and projection. An instrument that carries over that room, that same instrument that doesn't have much power, probably not going to have much projection either. And the list goes on and on. An instrument that sounds powerful, that sounds loud under the ear, may not actually carry very well over a large space. This is why it's crucial to break out the sense of bigness into these three P's. So the first demonstration is two instruments, one of which, by my evaluation, has a lot of presence, the other which does not. Right? I'm going to play the same excerpt on both instruments, and I encourage you to listen for this specific definition of presence. Which instrument sounds like it's more nearby, even though I'm no further away or no distance, no more distant? Thank you. sound very distant, right? It's really difficult to tell as a player under your ear how much presence an instrument has. All you're really able to determine is the power. But having recorded these instruments here in this space with the high quality microphone, you could pretty easily tell that the second instrument by far and away has more presence than the first instrument. And that's a really crucial thing too. Many of these characteristics of sound have a lot to do with how they carry across a space. So if you're in the market for an instrument, for example, it's really crucial to either get trusted ears out in back of the hall or to record yourself playing the instrument so you can detect how much presence or projection the instrument has. The next characteristic I want to walk you through is brilliance. We know that sound essentially consists of two parts, the fundamental pitch, or the pitch that actually sounds on the instrument. For example, if I say I'm going to play a B flat on this violin, that B flat that I put my finger on, that's the fundamental. But sound also consists of overtones. Overtones being resultant frequencies that occur above the fundamental pitch when that sound mixes with itself in a space and with all the different acoustical aspects of the instrument. It's the reason different instruments have different qualities of sound. It's the reason we have timbre. In other words, why a trumpet sounds different from a violin, why my voice sounds different from anyone else's voice. This is because of the relative strength and quantity of overtones created by the resonating body. And so brilliance, by our definition, is the sense of strength and quantity of overtones. And that spectrum goes from dull to brilliant. So an instrument that's dull is one which seems to have very few or very weak overtones. And then brilliant, on the other hand, has very strong and numerous overtones. And this is another critical junction here, where we're going to start this process of quantitative assessment in order to be even more specific about how well the instruments are doing. So when we talked about presence at first, we only went as far as saying this instrument has more than that instrument, right? A very binary kind of assessment. Now we're going to put it on a scale, 0 to 30. I found that if you go higher than 30, you have a little too much resolution. The difference between an instrument that's a 41 versus a 42 is kind of negligible. There's no point. That means that that scale is too tall. Whereas if you go lower than 30, for example, 0 out of 10, you don't have enough resolution in the scale. An instrument that is an 8 might actually have a little more presence, for example, than an instrument that also has an 8. 30, I found to be the sweet spot. That's the right amount of resolution in order to be specific, but not be lost in a wasteland of ambiguity. So I'm now going to demonstrate two more instruments that have differing amounts of brilliance. And we're afterwards going to put them on this scale from 0 to 30.
Thank you.
So the first instrument, by my assessment, on a scale from 0 to 30, I give it a 27. I think it has a lot of overtones, it has a lot of sensation of this sparkle in the sound, and it's also worth noting that brilliance is not in its own separate sphere away from the three P's. Brilliance oftentimes contributes to a sense of presence. And I think that's a really crucial thing too, is all these characteristics of sound that we're talking about don't exist in their own little atmospheres. These characteristics of sound all interlink with each other like a Venn diagram. So a sense of brilliance also creates a sense of presence. The second instrument, on the other hand, I give it a 2. Very, very, very dull. Very, very, very dull. Little sense of overtone, little sense of brilliance. The sound has this sense that it sort of just falls splat on the floor right in front of you. And I think it's also worth noting, too, I gave this instrument a 2, and on face value, you might be a little bit shocked by that, because over your life as a student, anything less than like a 70, we view that as a little bit insulting and like a massive failure, right? But what's the point of having a scale from 0 to 30 if you're not going to use the bottom 70% of it? It's really important to assess these instruments as though they don't have feelings, because, well, they don't. Don't be afraid to give an instrument a 2. In the same way, you would not be afraid to give a student a 2 if they didn't have feelings, right? It's not a student, you're not doing an assessment that has an effect on anyone's feelings. Don't be afraid to use the low end of the spectrum. Resonance is the companion characteristic to brilliance. We talked about brilliance as being the quantity and strength of the overtones. Now what about the fundamental? That's where resonance comes in. The sense of strength of the fundamental, and as I said, it's usually discussed as a companion to brilliance because, well, they're just two sides of the same coin, right? The relative amount of strength versus the bottom and the top of the sound, right? So once again, we have a spectrum here, and these seem like very simple words to use, weak versus strong. But the reality is, that's what resonance does. It gives an instrument a sense of strength versus something that sounds kind of whiny, kind of flimsy, if it doesn't have enough resonance. Or sometimes even going so far as to make the instrument sound very nasal, right? Again, we're gonna put this on our same spectrum, from 0 to 30. I'm gonna play two more instruments. Now take your attention away from overtones, away from the upper partials of the sound, and move it down to the fundamental, right? We're no longer concerned with brilliance as we make this assessment of resonance. But after we talk about resonance, we can talk about the complete package as a companion with brilliance.
Thank you.
Now, both under my ear and having listened to recordings of these two instruments, the first one I assess to have an 8 out of 30 in terms of resonance. It has a fair amount of brilliance. You get a good sense of overtones, a good sense of ring, a good sense of brilliance, but the fundamental just isn't there. It doesn't have much of a sense of strength. It sounds very weak. And as a result, this instrument would probably also have very low projection. It'd be very difficult to hear it over an ensemble. The second instrument, on the other hand, has an abundance of resonance. The fundamental is so strong that it almost dominates the overtones. That instrument has kind of the opposite problem, in my opinion. We have too much resonance, almost at the expense of brilliance. Now, having heard that, you would think that resonance and brilliance are inversely related, that you can have one or the other. But in fact, in an ideal world, you have an instrument that is both brilliant and resonant. You do not need one at the expense of the other. They should appear in balance. The next characteristic I want to talk you through is texture. Texture of the sound is the sense of sandiness or noise in the sound. Oftentimes we describe that as the instrument having giving the illusion that it's breathing, or that sense of friction under the bow. Sometimes you hear it as kind of a hiss. And I chose to share this one with you for two reasons. Firstly, there's a playability characteristic that is almost identical to texture. We call it sandiness. It's that same sense of friction, not in the sound, but in the sensation under the bow. And this is a case where addressing the texture of the sound would oftentimes improve the playability or the sandiness under the bow, and vice versa. You can address the playability under the bow, the sense of sandiness, and it will also have an effect on the texture of the sound. And that's crucial. We've frequently found in our research that by addressing a matter of playability, you get an equally positive result in the world of sound, and vice versa. The second reason I want to share texture is because the spectrum for this looks a little bit different, right? We have sandy, the ideal point in the middle, right? This is a characteristic that you want in balance. It can very easily become a situation of too much of a good thing. If you have too much texture in the sound, it can sound gritty. It can sound almost like there's gravel on the string under the bow. Or on the flip side of the spectrum, if there's not enough of that sense of friction in the sound, it sounds very glassy. It almost sounds like the bow's not catching on the string, and don't you know it, the playability of the instrument usually reflects this as well. So I'm going to play two instruments that you've already heard. These are both instruments that are functioning on a very high level, so they're good apples to apples for comparison here. One of them I find to be on the glassy end of the spectrum. The other I find to be on the gritty end of the spectrum. So I hope that by both being a very high quality instrument, it'll be easy to isolate the sense of texture.
Thank you.
instruments. Neither of them is excessively glassy or excessively gritty, but the first one, I give it a 25 out of 30 on the glassy end of the spectrum. And remember, that's influenced by the fact that I'm playing the instrument, that I'm also experiencing the sandiness of it from a tactile standpoint. But even in the sound, there's just not enough texture. There's not enough stuff to chew on. And then the other instrument, it's not really worse, but it's on the other end of the spectrum. There's almost a little bit too much noise, a little bit too much crackle and pop, away from the ideal sense of texture that I long for in an instrument. And again, that's reflected in the playability in terms of sandiness, in the sense of friction under the bow. The last characteristic of sound I want to share with you is called vowel sound. And this one is unique. It's going to require a different kind of listening than we've been doing so far. Up to this point, we've been picking apart the sound, almost looking at it reductively, in order to isolate one specific nuance in the sound. I chose to share vowel sound with you because it requires kind of the opposite kind of listening. Vowel sound is a composite characteristic. It's the instrument's voice, or the sum vowel its sound resembles. In other words, how are all of these other characteristics of sound coming together to create the instrument's voice? And usually the type of words we use to describe the voice of an instrument or the character of the sound is, this sound is nasal, this sound is dark or bright. That's usually where those ambiguous words come into play. Instead, for vowel sound, we use the 20 IPA vowel sounds, right? Pit, pet, hat, cut, put, dog, you name it, including all the diphthongs, all that jazz, right? So a word like hard, the vowel sound being ah, tends to sound very strong. Usually instruments that have a lot of resonance tend to have a sense of ah in the vowel sound. Compare that to boot. Ooh, the vowel sound is usually an instrument you might describe as being quite sweet. It might be lacking in projection or presence or power. It's perhaps a more modest kind of sound, but very pleasant, right? And ah versus ooh, is one better than another? Not necessarily. This is down to personal preference. There's no objective right answer or scale or spectrum to put this on. Now, I like to contrast ah and ooh with a, as you hear in the word care, right? The vowel sound a is kind of unanimously unpleasant. It tends to sound very penetrating, almost like a mosquito in your ear, frequently described as nasal, right? So ah and oo tend to be more desirable than a, even though there's no real spectrum we could put them on. So if you're evaluating for your own purposes, you might say ah is my desired vowel sound. So if I encounter an instrument that has ah as a vowel sound, I'll give it a 30. Or if I encounter an instrument that has oo as a vowel sound, I don't mind it, I don't hate it, but I don't love it, so I'll give it a 15. Okay? So the spectrum here, the quantitative rating system, is much different. And it's also worth noting, too, that this is also a very, very, very personalized thing. I might hear an instrument and hear the oo vowel sound. You might hear the ah vowel sound. That's okay, because remember, you're evaluating these instruments for your own purposes, or at the very least, to describe to someone else what your experience is, even if you don't share the same experience. So these are specific terms. This is a specific term that we use to describe something that is a little more abstract, a bit more personal. So lastly, I'm going to play one more excerpt on two violins that, by my assessment, have very different vowel sounds. See if you can hear the difference. Zoom out of these specific nuances that we've been talking about and listen to the entire composite impression that the sound gives you.
Thank you.
So the first instrument, the impression it gives me is a sense of ooh, as in boot. I hear a very nice balance between glassy and gritty. It's a very nice sandy as far as the texture goes, which makes it not very assuming. It makes it a very pleasant sound, but it also doesn't have a ton of presence, doesn't have a ton of projection, doesn't give a sense of power under the ear. As a result, it sounds quite sweet to my ear. Now again, you may have had a different impression. That's okay. Neither of us is wrong. But if you were a maker I was dialoguing with, I would describe to you the general sense of the sound that I get by using ooh. It doesn't have to be correct. The sense of correctness here is arbitrary, right? The words are specific, but there's no correct way to hear this sound. The second instrument I hear as the ah sound. Remember, this is the instrument that had a 29 out of 30 in terms of resonance. And like I said, that sense of strength in resonance gives a sense of ah, sort of like a chest voice, like an operatic baritone might have. Okay? So, lastly, now that you've developed a language, now that you have a close understanding of what each other is talking about in this collaboration with the violin maker, how do you take these observations and how do they culminate in an overall assessment of the instrument? And we found that the best way to do this in a very clear communicative way is with a quantitative assessment. Right? So why is this important? Right? You have to be able to describe the relative importance and severity of a problem. If I describe to Keith, this instrument sounds too gritty. Okay, how big of an issue is that? How important is grittiness in the sound of an instrument? And how much is too much grit? Who knows if all you have is three terms, right? We need a longer spectrum. It also is very useful in describing the significance of an improvement. If I were to tell Keith, oh yeah, that's better, Keith might think, wow, this is a revolutionary improvement, whereas I'm thinking, okay, this went from a 22 out of 30 to a 23. Right, that's a very important thing to be on the same page about. Secondly, from a practical standpoint, even if you're not working directly with the maker, right, this gives you an absolute criteria for commissioning an instrument. Say, for example, you walk in, you lay down a very hefty down payment, and you need to know that when you go back and the instrument is complete and you get to choose whether or not to accept it, that you are going to have a threshold. You're going to have a concrete way of saying, no, this instrument is not what I wanted it to be, or walk away with peace of mind knowing it is what you wanted it to be. And the same thing goes if you're shopping comparatively for a new instrument. If you're able to rank quantitatively the instruments that you're looking at in terms of the characteristics that are most important to you, all of a sudden the buying process becomes much easier, it offers a lot more peace of mind, and it also becomes much more efficient when you're comparing sound and price. Lastly, being able to quantify which characteristics are strong or weak on your instrument also allows you to play better. It allows you to play to your strengths and weaknesses. If I'm in a string quartet playing an instrument that I know to be very brilliant, I'm going to play a lot differently as a second violinist than I would if I'm playing an instrument I know sounds very dull. You're going to play differently depending on the strengths and weaknesses of the instrument. And if you know in a very concrete way what those strengths and weaknesses are, you're going to be a more informed, more sensitive player. So, how to do this? How on earth to assess these instruments on the whole in the composite? If you take out the handout you picked up at the door, you'll find a blank rubric that I've created for doing just that. You'll see on this rubric, in the left-hand column, you have in list form all of the characteristics of sound and playability that made the cut, so to speak, that are important enough. I've organized them into three categories: characteristics of sound, characteristics of right-hand playability, in other words, playability concerns for the bow, and playability characteristics of the left hand, in other words, how does the left hand feel? Is it having an easy enough time? Now let's break down how this rubric works. You'll notice there are also two pre-filled out examples. that I've done on the last two instruments you heard me play. Right? The second to last instrument was Opus 531, the one with the oo vowel sound, and Opus 509 was the last instrument I played, the one with the ah vowel sound. So take a look at Opus 531, the one with the oo vowel sound. So if we work our way to the right on the rubric, of course you have your characteristics of sound, and at the top of the rubric I put the ones that we discussed today: power, presence, projection, texture, vowel sound, brilliance, resonance. In the next column, of course, is the score out of 30 that we awarded to the violin. So far, this is familiar territory. The next category, the weight multiplier, is the opportunity to prioritize different characteristics in the numerical assessment of the instrument. So for example, presence, you'll notice on the 531 rubric, I've assigned it a weight multiplier of 5. That means when I give that violin a grade out of 30 on presence, it's multiplied by 5. So now instead of being out of 30, I've weighted it, so now it's out of 150. Compare that to vowel sound, for example. I've given that a weight multiplier of 1. In other words, no multiplier. So as a result, presence is going to factor much more strongly into the success, into the output assessment, into the number, the percentage of success that this instrument gets, than vowel sound does. It's like weighting the grades in a grade book for a class you're teaching. And then, of course, the last segment here, the last column, weighted score, is the score out of 30 multiplied by the multiplier. Right? So, this tabulation section at the bottom is where all of this comes together. The total weighted score is the total number of points that that instrument has earned, including the weight modifiers. Right? And the max weighted score, of course, is the maximum possible number of points the instrument could have earned with the weight multipliers. And then using those two numbers, you can very easily give it a percentage grade. Now, when we're talking about instruments, again, in academia, or if you're grading students, anything below a 70 kind of feels like a slap in the wrist. But in this case, we're utilizing the entire scale from 0 to 100%. So an instrument from 0 to 40, as opposed to like 70, we would consider that to be pretty disastrous. This instrument, for example, I've rated it a 32% based on my quantitative assessments. Right? 41 to 60%, kind of underwhelming. Pretty underwhelming. This instrument fits in that category. 61 to 80%. Okay, now we're talking about instruments that deserve a second look. Okay, these are respectable instruments, instruments that professionals would consider. And keep in mind, too, that the relative successful score of an instrument depends on my particular preferences, my individualized weighted scores. Right? So one person who might have a different system of weighting than I do would give different characteristics high weight multipliers. That instrument that's in the respectable category for me could very easily find itself in the excellent category for someone who had different priorities. 81 to 90% are the instruments that tend to rise to the top of the heap in my work with Keith. These are really great instruments. And then 91 to 100% is kind of reserved for the best instruments there have ever been, right? The Strats, Guarneri's, the usual suspects. And in a perfect world, right, 100% is the ideal instrument. If an instrument ever achieves 100%, that means there's something wrong with the scale. It's kind of like curving an exam in college. If everyone's getting 100%, right, then that's a problem. You need to make the exam difficult enough that you relatively have to curve it so that, you know, a lower percentage has a relative success factor. So now let's look at these two instruments by comparison. If you look back at the 531 rubric, we see that its deficiencies are in high weighted categories. For example, projection, right? I give projection a times 4 multiplier. That's a very important characteristic to me. And violin 531 received a 15 out of 30 in that high-weighted category. Right? Same goes for brilliance. That's a times 3 weighted category, and the instrument got a 19. So its deficiencies are in categories that I place high value on using my weight multipliers. 509, on the other hand, has deficiencies in places with relatively low weight multipliers. For example, down in playability, you see ease of legato. That doesn't just get a times 1 multiplier in my book, that gets a 1/2 multiplier in my book. That's how insignificant it is to me. And this instrument has a deficit there. It only gets 16 out of 30. But in the grand scheme of things, that's not a big deal, because that's a very low-weighted category by my assessment. Same with clarity of drops, 10 out of 30. But the weight multiplier is only times 1. So relatively speaking, if we look at the tabulations here, Opus 509 clearly comes out on top with an 82.3%. That's a very good grade. Whereas Opus 531 comes out at 72.6, simply because its deficiencies were in categories that I value very highly. Now again, for you, it might be completely different, right? It all depends on those weight multipliers and what you value in the sound and the playability of an instrument. Now, how do we take this into the realm of practicality? Say, for example, you're shopping for instruments and you have that very common quandary where you have two instruments, one of which is more expensive and sounds better, and the other which is less expensive but sounds marginally less good. How do you know if this instrument is worth the extra money? Well, let's assign hypothetical prices to these two instruments. Let's say Opus 531, you encounter it in a shop for $20,000. And these are totally arbitrary prices, prices you might encounter in a realistic violin search. So Opus 531, let's say it's on sale for $20,000, whereas Opus 509 is on sale for $25,000. How do you determine if that difference in quality, that difference in your assessment, is worth the extra $5,000? Well, let's find out. So the difference between the two in price, $5,000. The difference in two in quality, 9.7%. So by simply dividing the two, you can determine that there's a $515 upcharge for every 1% of improvement between those two instruments. Now, is there some kind of concrete scale where I'm going to say this dollar amount per percentage is worth it and this dollar amount is not? No, there is no concrete scale that determines, is this amount of money worth that improvement? Who knows? That's up to you. But what's crucial here is if you had a Stradivarius sitting in front of you worth, you know, $2 million that achieved 82.3%, you're going to be paying vastly more per percent improvement for that instrument than you are for Opus 509. Is it wrong to buy the $2 million Strat because you get less for your money? No, that's not wrong. But what this does is allows you to see what you're paying for. If you're buying a $2 million Strat, you're putting a lot of money into provenance, into name, into age, into, you know, it's been around for a long time, so the sound is probably marginally better as well. This exercise here is not meant to cut a threshold and say if you're paying more than $1,000 per percent, it's not worth it. No, all this does is point out and shine a light on what you are paying for. Are you paying for sound or are you paying for name? So the takeaways here. This system of specific language and quantizing these improvements is meant to inform your intuition, not to replace it, right? The bottom line is playing these instruments and hearing these instruments is a subjective, and it's a very emotional, intuitive, expressive experience that's different for every single person. This system is not meant to concretely tell you, is this instrument better than another? It's not meant for that. But what it is meant for is so that when you are playing an instrument and you feel that it's better, it's more suited for you, you're able to figure out why. You're able to put your finger on and explain and describe what you're experiencing intuitively. And to be able to bounce that back to the person who's going to help you improve that instrument or who's going to build the next instrument for you. Secondly, find luthiers who recognize the mutual benefit of this kind of work. If you're helping violin makers make improvements that are really significant and powerful to us as players, they're going to make better instruments. More better instruments in the world is better for us and better for them as they're trying to sell instruments. Find makers who accept this and are willing to go the extra mile, who are willing to listen to players and are willing to leave the ego at home in order to create instruments that are better. Lastly, and this is going to make it sound a little bit like a manifesto, but inspire Renaissance. I mean, we spend so much time longing for the old days of Cremona, these great old Italian masterpiece instruments. Why shouldn't that kind of zenith come back again? Why shouldn't makers be producing instruments on that level now or in the future? Why is that a thing of the past? We can take part in that inspiration, in that process of creating progress and inspiring makers to do so. And lastly, if for no other reason, do it to make Ayrton Senna happy. Thank you.